Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Brown Bears Sports Report. My name is Scott Cordischi, social media specialist here at Brown University, and today we're happy to be joined by the men's and women's water polo teams on the show. Before we welcome our guests, however, let me tell you that today's program is brought to you in part by My Box of Rhode Island. When it comes to moving and storage, My Box of Rhode Island brings the storage to you. It's moving made easy. No need to rent a delivery truck, no making multiple trips to load a storage unit. Call My Box of Rhode Island at 401-597-6400. And it gives me great pleasure right now to welcome to the show the head coach for our men's and women's water polo programs here at Brown, Felix Mercado. Felix, how are you?
I'm good. How are you, Scott? Thanks for doing this.
Well, I'm doing great. And Felix, thank you for joining us. And we look forward to talking to your student athletes who are with us tonight as well. From the men's team, we have rising sophomore Dan McDermott. Dan, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having us.
Dan, thank you for joining us. Also, a rising senior for the men's team, Riad Hallal. Riad, how are you?
Hey, doing well.
Thank you for joining us, Riad. And from the women's water polo program here at Brown, rising senior, Carissa Perez. I think, you know, she rolls the R's better than I do. I tried, Carissa. How are you?
I'm doing well, Scott. How about yourself?
I'm doing great. Thank you for joining us. And rising sophomore, Claire Pisani is with us as well. Claire, how are you today?
I'm great. Thanks for having us.
Well, thank you for joining us. Felix, let's start with you. So you were able to get the men's season in the fall. Unfortunately, the women's season got cut short. You got about half of it in. In fact, when the season ended, the girls were ranked 25th in the nation, off to a nice 12-2 start.
Yes, I wouldn't say it's bittersweet. I don't think that's the right word, but it was a little bit, I also don't want to be over dramatic and be like it was devastating, but it did leave a bad taste in our mouths. I think that because we knew that we were heading in the right directions as far as like improving. We had a lot of our young athletes like Claire, you know, that are our freshmen who are doing such a good job and getting better, you know, through the ups and downs of the seasons. And I feel like we were getting ready to hit our stride, especially when we were getting ready to go out to California for our spring break trip.
And Felix, in the fall, your men's team finished with a record of 22-12, but it was nice that the seniors got to finish with that exciting win in the third place game of the NWPC championship.
Yes, that was, we had some tough injuries at the end of the season, which kind of, you know, I think we didn't meet our goals as far as being able to compete at our best because of the injuries. But winning that third place game was huge, especially in the way we did it. The water polo games usually takes about an hour. This game took almost 2 hours to complete. Went to sudden death, sudden victory. And one of our seniors scored the winning goal, Armin Dermingian. So it was exciting, but a little nerve wracking.
Riad, you're the goalkeeper for the men's water polo program here at Brown. And I wanted to ask you this question. What is the best measure of success for a goalkeeper? Is it save percentage? Is it, you know, goals against average? Is it just simply wins and losses?
I think especially in water polo, it's a little more tricky because a lot of it is more reliant on your defense and your play style. I think the best measure of a goalkeeper, first off, has to be someone who's been on a team for a while, and it's just seeing how their defense plays. Because at the end of the day, you know, the goalkeeper is not just responsible for blocking shots, but you're also responsible for setting up the defense and organizing it in a way that everyone's going to be successful. So I think it's how well your team does defensively.
Coach, being familiar with the sport, I will say this. Goalkeeper is not an easy position to play, is it?
Definitely not the easiest.
Coach Mercado?
Oh yeah, no, I don't think it is. I think it's easy as far as training because they don't really have to swim. But as far as I think I'm going to stick up for the field players here that they, yeah, it is mentally challenging in certain spots. But it's tougher mentally than it is physically, you know, they still have to be in good shape. So
Dan, for you, you were a freshman this past fall, not a ton of experience, but I'm sure this is something you're looking forward to building up, correct? Over the next three seasons, getting more time in the pool?
Yes, absolutely. I'm really excited for the next few years.
And tell me what your freshman year was like in terms of being a member of the program and managing your time between athletics and academics.
Well, I loved it. It was, this has been the most enjoyable team that I've been on, like as a player thus far. Best coaches I've ever had, best teammates I've ever had. They're some of my best friends. And managing my time was definitely a challenge, but you kind of get forced into doing it, because when you have such little time to do your work and to get things done, you kind of have to do it anyway. So it works out.
Carissa, as we talked to Coach about, your season was cut short due to the pandemic. First of all, what do you remember about that day that you were told the season was over and that life on campus was over? You'd have to be going home and partaking in remote learning after spring break. Tell us what your reaction was and maybe what you remember about that day and that time.
Well, actually, the weekend beforehand, we were at Harvard playing some games, and we actually heard that Harvard canceled their spring break trip. So we already knew that there was a chance that our spring break trip was going to get canceled. So we kind of went back to school having that mentality that there was a chance that our season was going to be affected in some way. But then 3 days later, or actually 2 days later, Felix told us that season's going to be affected, but we're still going to try and keep it going underway and just schedule as many games as possible without traveling outside of the allocated area. But it ends up the day after that, everything was released from Ivy League's network saying that season was canceled and that spring athletics were no longer going to continue. And I think all of us were kind of shocked, and more of we just couldn't believe it, because it just seemed so hypothetical that there was just so many questions that were not able to be answered that it just seemed so unreal.
You have had an amazing three seasons in the pool for this program. I mean, 65 points, 92 points, 55 points in 14 games before the season was cut short. Just tell me about your experience as part of this women's water polo team.
I will say that coming into Brown, I'm just so thankful for the opportunity, and I'm especially thankful to have such a great coach like Felix. And I feel like being guided by Felix as a coach has enabled me to actually play the best that I can, because I know having such a supportive coach to fall back on, knowing if I ever make a mistake, will just allow me to continue to better myself and go into every game knowing that I want to play well and also make my team and my coach proud. So I'll just say that playing for Brown just allowed me to take water polo in a different direction, I would say.
Felix, talk a little bit about Carissa. How talented is she? I mean, her numbers really speak for themselves.
She's very talented, but it's not because she's just got this natural. She works really, really hard to be as good as she is. And you know, if you see her in person, she's not the most towering person, but she plays a lot bigger than she is. And just her vision, I think I would compare her to probably like a Magic Johnson, John Stockton type of player in our sport, her vision. And I think Claire would tell you, because she's been on the receiving end of some great passes from Carissa. And I think one thing she was doing this year that she hadn't really done in the past 2 years was she was putting the ball away early on. She did a great job of scoring the ball, and it wasn't something that I said, Carissa, I need you to score more. She just saw the opportunities, and before she would just, you know, look to pass, but while she was still looking to make the pass, she saw an opportunity. You could just see her confidence was just like, I could put this shot away. She's going to be very, very scary next year. Not for us. We're going to be fired up to, I think she's going to have an incredible senior year, because you could just see how she's improved because of the work she's put in.
Claire, as a freshman, you saw plenty of action this spring before the season was cut short, and you actually had a couple of goals against Austin College in a game I was lucky enough to call on ESPN+. But just talk to us about your experience freshman year.
Yeah, it's been great. I mean, sort of echoing what Daniel said, like, the women's team is awesome and just super supportive, and I feel like I've blossomed as a player on this team, you know, under Felix's coaching, and just, again, with really supportive teammates. And like Felix was saying, like, I rely on, like, especially in the position that I'm in as center, like, I really rely on my teammates for really, like, helping make these, like, all the goals that you said, like, make those happen. Just, like, you know, it's all about teamwork, and I really appreciate, like, being on a team where I can really rely on my teammates. Yeah.
Claire, I always like to ask freshmen about, you know, their first year in terms of time management. They always say that's the most important thing to get down, right? Because you're so busy with your classes and your academics and your homework. And then being a student athlete is like having a full-time job on top of that. How did you find time management or managing your time this year? Did you find that it wasn't as difficult as you thought it might be?
It's definitely challenging. I would say that in high school, I also had a really challenging sort of academic go. So I think I was really prepared coming into Brown. But I mean, still, again, really challenging, balancing that. But I think also now sort of having been in quarantine for the rest of the semester, I've come to really appreciate like sort of the structure that athletics and like water polo has given me, because I think sort of being an athlete and having to schedule my academics and like really try to figure out how to balance all of that, is it forces you to be a lot more efficient and to really just focus and put 100% into what you're doing, both academically and athletically, because there's so limited time to fit everything into it. So while it's challenging, it's something that I really miss, having been without that for the past month or two.
Felix, that women's game, the win over Austin College, I had a chance to broadcast with one of your men's players, Aiden Riley. Does he have a future in broadcasting? Did you get a chance to watch?
I did get a chance to watch, and I think he would like to get into broadcasting. It's funny, like the guys in the team who had opportunities to fill in on the streaming with ESPN Plus, they were so like, just, they got to be someone they've always, it's almost like they became an actor, or like became to play a role that they never thought they would. And you could just tell going back and listening to their play by play, their enthusiasm was just like, it was really enjoyable to listen to them, because those are their thoughts were pure. The way they saw the game, the way they supported the women's team out there, because they did a couple of games. Thank you so much for doing that one game. And we were, they filled in some other games, and it was really really, really cool to hear them doing that, especially Aiden did a good job.
And these new multi-camera productions, I think, really have enhanced, the broadcast of your games, men and women's water polo games.
Yeah, if I'm knocking on wood, hoping that we get a chance to play in the fall, that if they limit the amount of people that can watch our games, the fact that we've just made our production so much like high level that anyone that isn't able to watch the game can just stay at home, watch ESPN Plus, they could get it's almost like you're there. So I'm excited for it. It was kind of cool to see it this year, and I'm glad that we got to do it for both the men and the women and moving forward.
Felix, tell us how you have been staying in contact with your players on both teams. Has there been a lot of Zoom meetings, a lot of texting, emails? And then talk about the town hall meeting you had with alumni and friends of the program. I thought that went very well.
Yes. As far as communicating with them, we had a couple of Zoom meetings, but I pretty much backed off of them for the most part. I reached out for them individually just because of how they didn't sign up to go home and take their finals and their classes online. So I didn't want to overwhelm them and create more of a hassle. I always reminded them that they had resources, because I think the one thing that Brown did, and the fact that, being a student athlete does help, is the fact that we were able to kind of line in our faculty liaison. We have professors that work with our team, or, the athletic department has a peer tutoring department ready to help anyone that needed it. So the fact that I was able to provide the resources if they needed them, the mental health resources or anything that had to do with them succeeding, because it's not about surviving for me with them, it's about them succeeding, made me again proud to be part of such a great university, and they did a good job. I mean, I can't tell you how proud I am of them. They're more than just my athletes. I don't want to say that they're my children, because I don't want to be that old, but they definitely are part of my life and a part of my family's life, that I, seeing them struggle like they, well, seeing them having to deal with the challenges that they had to, I was worried and nervous and praying that they would come out of it okay, and they did, the town hall, we were able to do town hall, which was really cool to see some of the alums that I'm obviously I'm hoping that you know, in 4 or 5 years from now, the four amazing student athletes that we have on this call will be part of our next town hall. And I think that's something that has a program we have to kind of Zoom. Almost this pandemic almost gave us these, showed us these different opportunities to stay in touch, right? Like, hey, like, well, nothing replaces face-to-face. Nothing replaces being able to hug my athletes. Nothing can ever replace that, right? Because I think that's like the most important thing, and seeing my alums and sharing a meal with them. But the fact that we're able to do this and take advantage of these tough times and create other opportunities to get together and feel like we're there. And it was amazing. And I'm definitely going to take this ability. And when we go back, is make sure that it's still part of our program, doing Zoom town halls, doing Zoom meetings for anything specific that needs to be done within what my compliance allows us to do. I don't want to break any rules, but I think that taking advantage of these opportunities moving forward is something that I think all of us will.
Dan, the academic year is now over with. Thankfully for you guys, you can kind of exhale a little bit. No more exams to worry about. How did you find the whole remote learning process? Obviously, it's not a great substitute for being in the classroom, but what was it like for you?
It was definitely a challenge because I missed out on being in my classes in person, and even just being able to study with friends and like in libraries, like trying to do my work at home was a challenge. But I think that the resources that Brown provided us was definitely helped with that process a lot. Like a lot of my professors had so many office hours. Just, they said at any point in time, if you ever need help, like just let us know. I had, for one of our final exams, my bio professor was available from midnight to 9 a.m. straight, because if anyone needed any kind of question whatsoever, he was ready and he would email within 1 minute. And I think that's just pretty incredible, like what Brown professors did for us, just to make this kind of challenging process a little bit easier.
That's terrific. What commitment from you, professor. Riad, how about you? Summer plans. I understand that you had some summer plans, but because of the pandemic, those are going to be changing.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously a lot of stuff's being canceled. Right now I'm kind of just, you know, playing it day by day. Trying to do whatever I can. Hopefully if pools open up, I'll be able to play a little bit, maybe get in with a master's team. Other than that, I'm thinking about taking a class online or doing some case study stuff. I know Brown's offering this virtual internship type program, 7 weeks, totally free. So I'm definitely going to apply to that. Really just doing whatever I can to stay connected and stay active.
Carissa, Claire, same question to you. Did you have summer plans and are they still on, or have you had to adjust and change those because of what we're going through right now?
Claire, do you want to go first?
You can go first if you want.
Okay. So this summer, I typically go back to my old high school and coach water polo out of there. But unfortunately, because of this pandemic going on, they canceled that. And I was planning to also shadow a sports psychologist because I'm studying psychology. But unfortunately, I think that is also going to get canceled because of everything. So fortunately, I think this is going to be the summer that I just get to spend time at home and enjoy and actually relax. So that'll be something different, but it's something to look forward to.
Claire, how about you?
So I'm planning on trying to either get a job at like a grocery store or maybe a coffee shop or something like that. I had planned originally to try to be a lifeguard, but a lot of pools aren't open, obviously, so that's going to be a little bit tricky to try to figure out. So I'm going to have to play it by ear and see what opens up over the summer. But yeah, for now, just trying to, you know, work like how I can. Yeah.
Dan, have you had a chance to see what some of your teammates have done with this FarmLink project? It's pretty cool, isn't it?
It's amazing. I'm dumbfounded by what they've done. It's really incredible. If you look at the Instagram and you look at social media and like what they've done, it's really, truly incredible. They're delivering food from excess food that farmers produce to these food banks. And it's really an amazing thing because it's something that they had time to do, and they're really like impacting lives, and they're changing lives for people who might not have enough to eat because of this pandemic, because they're losing their jobs. I think that's really an incredible, incredible thing that they're doing.
Yeah, Riad was pretty smart because I was reading and watching the same stories on TV about, you know, these farms, you know, getting rid of excess stuff just because there wasn't the market for it. And, you know, they're getting rid of gallons of milk and they're destroying eggs and they're burying vegetables and fruits. And for these guys to figure out that, hey, we can make something good out of this, I thought that was really neat.
Absolutely. Very, very proud of my teammates. Both of the two guys who started it are incredibly smart individuals, and they recognized that there was a problem, and they cared. So they did something about it, and it's cool to see how it's kind of spread to even like alumni, like Will Rankin, the goalie before me, has been helping out with it. I think it's really cool that in a time like this, they can come together and make an actual difference.
Felix, it has to make you pretty proud as the coach that recruited them to Brown, doesn't it?
Yes. And you know, it's funny. I was actually talking to Aiden Riley today and about certain different things, but then we started talking about FarmLink and I told him how proud I am. But I also was like, I would say it's almost what Brown embodies as far as giving back and being active and not thinking about yourself, right? That it's, and I'm not saying that other universities don't have this quality, but Brown, in particular, I think has a reputation that the student, the alums will tell you, and obviously the current student body, that it's, if they have an opportunity to make a difference and give back and help someone, regardless of what it is, it's, they don't even think twice about it. And this FarmLink thing it came out of nowhere, and I remember them talking to me about it, and like, they're like, hey, can you mail it out? Can you send that to the alums? And I'm like, well, first of all, I got to make sure that, okay, going back to making sure it's compliant, that we can do this. We got the thumbs up from our great compliance department. And then we started just like blasting the social media part of it. And, you know, he did say like other, like how crazy it was that other students, not just from Brown, also were like, what a great idea. What can I do to help? And it reached out to so many other people. And it was almost like, again, in times like this brings out the best of people. Or no one really realizes how unselfish you can be. And when you don't have to think about it, just act, you just do it because why? It's the right thing to do. Obviously I'm proud of them. I'm proud of the I don't want to say the choices they've made to make this an important part of their summer and their spring, on top of getting through finals and finishing up school and it's a lot of work, and I'm glad that they're going to continue this through the summer. Hopefully, you know, again, we can, as a community at Brown University, the alums, we continue to do whatever we can, whenever we can, to continue to help, because I think this is probably a problem that we've always had, and we never even realized it, you know. And sure. So to give farmers an opportunity to be productive and stay and be part of helping food banks. I mean, it's almost like a perfect situation, you know?
Absolutely. Carissa, you talked about, you know, because of the situation, maybe enjoying an unexpected relaxing summer this year at home. We can certainly think of worse places to be than in the Los Angeles area if you have to relax for the summer, right? But I'm just curious, what are you doing to avoid just, you know, going nuts, sitting in the house all day? You get out for a run, you ride your bike. I mean, what are you doing to kind of keep the mind and the body fresh?
Well, fortunately enough, I do have a weight set, and I've been trying to lift every day, getting some form of exercise in before I start my day. And I have a dog that is a year and a half and has endless energy. So we'd spend a lot of time outside in my backyard playing fetch. And I also have a pool that I try and get into. And hopefully once the weather gets a little bit more warm, I could hop in and actually do a little bit more water polo exercises. But right now, just enjoying the time being outside in my backyard is the way to pass time, I would say.
Claire, how about you? You're a little bit north of Carissa, up outside the San Francisco area in Redwood City. What are you doing to, I guess, pass the time and you know, kind of like I said, keep the body and the mind fresh?
Definitely the same deal with the pool. It's a little bit cold still, but as it starts to get warmer up here, I'll be doing the same, getting in and really working my legs and trying to, you know, stay in shape in the pool. For right now, I've been going on lots of like walks and hikes with friends, you know, 6 feet apart, the whole know, social distancing deal, but really just trying to take this opportunity home to reconnect with people from high school and, you know, just people in my life that I haven't had the chance to see in a while. Yeah, I play ping pong every day with my brother. That's like our little, like, we bond every day, but he plays tennis, so he's really good at ping pong. So we, I get my butt kicked by him every day at ping pong. So, yeah, staying active with people from home.
Riad, you're out in California as well. What do you miss most about being on campus at Brown?
I think the people, obviously. I miss my teammates, my roommates. And it's difficult because, like, you know, as a, I'm sure it's obviously much more difficult for the seniors, but as a junior, like, you know, I've got 1 year left and kind of all, you know, happening really quickly. So it's kind of made me appreciate the time that I have just with the people at Brown that I might not have a chance to be as close to out of college.
Dan, you're a little bit closer to campus, located in Greenwich, Connecticut, just a couple of hours away. What do you miss most about being here on campus?
I'm with Riad. I definitely miss the people most. I miss spending time with my friends, and I miss my teammates, and that's really tough. But we're definitely all staying in touch as best we can with, like, the technology we have. Yeah.
Felix, I want to let you have the last word today. And if you'd like to say anything to your seniors for both the men's and women's team that will be graduating.
You know, obviously, I've been since this is the senior week, and this weekend was supposed to be their graduation. You know, I think the fact that, and I'm looking at Carissa and Riad, that next year's graduation is going to be absolutely amazing because Brown's going to honor the 2020 seniors and the 2021 seniors together. So I think College Hill is going to be a nonstop party for seven straight days. I'm excited for that. But I don't think I need to say anything more to them that I've already, because I've kind of, like, it's almost like beating a dead horse. I love them, I miss them, and all that stuff. But I know that I will see them again because that's the kind of family we have, you know. I know that it's that we're that when that they'll I'll get a random phone call from them, and when I know whenever our team is where they're going to be, I know they're going to come and see their former teammates, and just and they're ever always going to be ever true to our Brown program, our Brown community, the university that shaped them to be the human beings that they are. Which, you know, as I'm sure the four athletes that are here will tell you, it's like they're great people. Our seniors are amazing human beings, and they're far from perfect, right? But it's definitely something that for us, because we're a family, it's more of a see you soon, right? Can't wait to see you next time. Look forward to next year when it's going to be, like I said, I cannot wait to next year's. I'm thinking about having our alumni game like at 3 o'clock in the morning, right after Cabot's dance, you know, in inner tubes. Yeah, it's gonna be the best. I'll make sure that the Nelson Fitness Center is open for that. But I'm going to make sure that I'm focusing on next year and not making, normally I'd probably be a wreck right now, you know, doing my sobbing and everything else that I do. But now that I'm just focusing on next year and saying, when I get them back on campus, we're going to make sure that they forget about all this, right? Or remember how through all of this, we became stronger, you know, and like I said, ever true to Brown, because, and to their teammates and to the community, because I truly believe that's, you can't say it any better way.
Well said, Coach, and thank you. And thanks to Dan, Riad, Carissa, and Claire. And I hope we're all back together on campus in the fall. Thank you all for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Scott.
All right, that'll do it for this edition of the Brown Bears Sports Report with the Brown men's and women's water polo teams. My name is Scott Cordischi. Thanks for joining us, everyone.
This has been a presentation of Learfield IMG College.